Greetings, this is Greg for Tesla Fan Insight. Today's talk focuses once again on the impact of the 2170 battery on the garbage truck solution in the Class A truck area, which is perhaps the most important, both pollution and Class 8 execution out there. Greetings, this is Greg for Tesla Fan Insight. Bonjour, today's talk focuses on the fact that we've been kind of going through and looking at the impact of the 2170 battery and how it's kind of changed the game for in favor of Tesla with no other competition in existence for this product. I was really fascinated by the fact that probably the most important implementation of this battery is in the form of the garbage truck solution. Why it's that important is the fact that because of the fact that garbage trucks travel a relatively short distance, about 100 miles, but between the engine use to lift and raise the back of the garbage truck plus the distance of the drive, there's a large amount of pollution generated by the vehicle. And what's also amazing, so continuing with our solution, one of the problems that's really popped up is the fact that, you know, you have all this pollution coming from this vehicle. All the numbers that we previously had were based on the 18650 battery, and basically this allowed a heavy Class 8 vehicle to go approximately 100 miles, but it didn't have enough juice so that you weren't immune from using a range extender of some sort to deal with the working of the back of the truck needed. Now with the 2170, not only do you have a long enough distance with the battery so you can go your full 100 miles, but you now have enough juice from a battery with double the power at less weight. But now you don't have to worry about using the power of the battery to operate the rear of the truck. So I think this really puts a hurting on companies like wrightspeed and other companies that were using electric to provide the primary drive of the vehicle along with range extender, maybe diesel or others, to address the operation of the rear of the truck. So I believe that this is going to result in a real sort of shrinking of the marketplace for wrightspeed and other sort of range extender dependent companies that were relying on that as a way to introduce products that, I don't know if it would be competing with Tesla, but we just enter a marketplace that Tesla really hasn't entered. So what I find interesting is even if those companies have already entered the marketplace, the fact that Tesla could come in and offer better prices and a better solution, particularly because they don't need a diesel range extender, the solution is better if you're trying to get rid of the pollution generated by the trucks. I think it's a big enough difference that some customers who are not long-term committed may choose to delay or cancel orders in order to move to the Tesla solution, and whoever that partner may be, and as I've shared, I think that partner would be Freightliner. Why, as we reviewed earlier, the reason why the truck solution in the form of the garbage truck is so huge is that the average truck that switches to electric, that's a garbage truck, will save on the order of $35,000 a year per truck to the entity that uses electric instead of diesel. So as a result, there's a huge both pollution, cost of repair, and gasoline reason why utilities dependent upon, utilities all over the world, both in Europe, for example, in the United States, even though fuel is somewhat down in the U.S. in price, there's a huge incentive to make the switch, because $35,000 a year per truck times 50 to 100 truck ends up being a huge savings. And now that we've moved to the 2170 battery, you're probably looking at 4 battery packs for a Class A truck. And now that we're seeing half the weight, and Tesla can make money at a lower cost, I would say that the break-even is likely in the 2-year range for a vehicle expected to go 5 to 7 years. So now you have a huge incentive for entities to quickly come after this. And, you know, we could even talk about the fact that in theory, for colder climates or very, very hot places, you could even in the middle of the day take time out to hit a supercharger if there are any problems with range issues for that vehicle. So this is a long-winded statement to say that we are kind of doing a process where we're going from situation to situation to review the value proposition of the brand new Tesla battery, and the fact that that value proposition sort of destroys competitors in both the truck side as well as the auto side. The other thing that's kind of been burning on my brain about what's going to happen with the new battery and its implementation is the fact that there's already kind of a bidding war going on to see who's going to, or which customers are going to see the solution first. And the way the bidding has gone thus far is for customers who have long-term relationships with people like Mercedes, who are a Tesla partner, are getting first dibs on this product. And I would say that because of the shortage of the batteries already, even for the Model 3 kind of has other issues as to why it's slowing down their deliveries. But I would just have to say that the solution is so compelling with the amount of money saved each year that, and I would say perhaps the most amount of money being saved even above a regular Class A truck that would be going long distance on a daily basis, that we're going to get a chance to see who the highest bidders are in the form of those trucking companies offering the most money to get that solution in place as fast as possible so they can bring those savings to the bottom line. I think that, I think the person who articulated the value proposition of the trucks most was the head of Wrightspeed, and he is a former co-founder of Tesla. But even he, given an early founder of Tesla, is sort of on the list of potential companies to get killed by his old firm, because technology is forcing down the weight and price of lithium-ion batteries. And even, you know, those who are well informed about how the process works can end up being victims of the environment. So it'll be interesting to see how Wrightspeed responds. I'm focused exclusively on Wrightspeed, even though BYD and other manufacturers involved are there, but everyone is doing the same thing relative to the range extender, because in the old iteration of the lithium-ion battery, there's so much weight required to deal with a Class 8 situation that the size of the battery needed to handle both the garbage truck operation and the operation of the truck was so large that you start to affect how much payload you can carry, i.e. garbage you can carry to your destination. So I just think that this is a pretty important iteration of how the 2170 will be used. And because of the amount of pollution generated and how valuable it is, I would not be surprised to see this truck be the first example of how Tesla and its partners elect to implement the 2170 in action. Because as he stated, it's definitely a Class 8 solution. It's definitely a solution that reduces pollution in high density areas nicely. It fits all the parameters of the target iteration that Elon Musk has discussed. I want to thank you once again for taking time out to visit with us regarding the Tesla and impact of its solution to the world. This is Greg for Tesla Fan Insight. Please like and subscribe. Look forward to our next conversation and have a great day. Thanks for now.